As if the solar system couldn't get any more fascinating, a brand new study suggests that oceans of water may be hiding within planets Uranus and Neptune. I want to bring in Adam Frank, professor of astrophysics at the University of Rochester and author of The Little Book of Aliens. It's great to see you again, Adam. So I'm dying to know what you think of this study.
Yeah, this is really interesting because, you know, Uranus and Neptune are the farthest planets in our solar system. We only visited them once, so we don't know much about them. And when we did go by, when we sent probes in the 80s, we found that they behaved, especially their magnetic fields, were really odd. So it told us we didn't understand what was going on inside. And these new results show us that everything we thought about the interiors was probably wrong. Rather than like a big ball of slush, there's actually probably a liquid ocean down there, quite deep, 3,000 miles deep. And then below that, another thick layer of kind of, it's carbon and nitrogen and hydrogen, kind of almost like plastic. It's, you know, almost like a polymer. So completely different kind of planet than we thought it might have been. And this is really important for all the other planets that we found in the universe, all these new exoplanets, because many of those are going to be what we call sub-Neptunes, slightly smaller than Neptune and Uranus, and they may have life.
So no spacecraft, as you just said, has conducted a flyby of Uranus or Neptune for, what, about 40 years? So do you think that this new information could make further exploration of those planets more compelling and therefore more likely?
Yeah, I think already there's plans on the board to do visits again to these planets. Because, you know, what's amazing about our solar system is that we've got Earth, which has one Earth mass, and then we've got Uranus and Neptune, which are like 17 or 14 Earth masses, and there's nothing in between. So we have no planets in between. But the most common kind of planet in the universe, the ones that we're finding around orbiting lots of stars, is exactly in that in-between. We call them super-Earths and sub-Neptunes. And these are the planets, since they're so common, that might have life. And so what we need to do is we need to understand Uranus and Neptune as a way of understanding the possibilities for all these sub-Neptunes and super-Earths that are like cheap as dirt in the solar and the rest of the galaxy.
Well, so you brought to me perfectly to my next question, which is, we all know, even those of us who are not scientists, that water is crucial for any form of life. So does it exponentially or just a little bit raise the possibility of extraterrestrial life on these planets?
Well, the important, that's a good question. And the important thing about this is what it's showing is it's all about pressure, right? When you dive down deep into these planets, these larger planets than the Earth, the pressures go up to crazy, crazy levels, millions of times more than the pressures that you find deep in the Earth. And things get weird there. The behavior of compounds, the behavior of chemicals, changes. And so actually this result is part of I'm actually part of the larger program, something called the Center for Matter at Atomic Pressures, where we're using giant lasers to squeeze stuff down to these super high pressures. And then you find that you can get liquid water under conditions that normally you'd be like, no way, that's just not possible. So what we're seeing with these results is that even in our solar system, we may have an example of a way of separating out water, of allowing water to exist in conditions that we wouldn't thought were possible. And that may have huge consequences for these other smaller worlds. We don't expect there's possibility for life on Uranus or Neptune, but these smaller sub-Neptunes that we're finding everywhere, some of those could be at the right temperatures to have, you know, microbes existing. And who knows if more than you might be able to get more than microbes.
So we only have 30 seconds left, but what are the chances, if you were a betting man, that in the next 10 years we find the answer to that, if they do or not?
Well, I would put money down that in the next 10 to 30 years, we will have data relevant to that question. I can't tell you what the data is going to say, but, you know, we've been asking this question for 2,500 years about life in the universe, and we're finally now on the cusp of actually getting data to tell us one way or the other.
This is awesome.
Very exciting.
And you make it exciting. Adam Frank, thank you. Come back soon. Appreciate it.